Warning, do not listen to this podcast if hearing about freedom and liberty is not legal for you in your community. And if so, you should immediately move to a hipper community.
Welcome to the Freedom Feens Podcast, a weekly web lab where Michael W. Dean and Neema Vedadi cover the punk rockinist, hip hopinist current events, as well as timeless universal truths about life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, because there's no such thing as half free. The Freedom Feens Podcast, available from freedomfeens.com. That's freedomfeens.com.
Go.
Rolling.
I've been calling my cat Peanut Peeny Fiend.
Peeny Fiend, you got it.
And you're Neema Fiend.
I'm Neema Fiend, and you're Michael Fiend instead of Michael Dean.
Michael Fiend, yep. My wife said, say hi to Neema Fiend for me.
We are the Freedom Fiends, you got it, yeah.
Yes. So, this is the first annual meeting of the non-voting anarchists for Ron Paul.
It has been an amazing thing how much presence he's had in the past couple weeks. It's almost, I think as Juan Williams said, it's the political age of Ron Paul.
Yeah, I think the Democrats are talking him up so it'll split the Republican vote.
Hey, we'll take it. I guess that is the problem is, CNN did a poll. He was the only one, who was closest to beating Obama in the poll. He did the best in a head-by-head matchup between him and Obama. But, you know, commentators are saying the reason is because, you know, the independents and the Democrats sort of favor him, but he'll never be able to win the Republican nomination. But, I mean, that just goes to show you how broken the party system is. If the guy that's most qualified to unseat the president can't get the Republican nomination, I mean, obviously there's a problem there.
Well, you know, he does poll well among the pro-heroin lobby, although most of them are non-voting felons.
The heroin comment was great. What did he say? I don't want to use heroin, so I need these laws.
Yeah. Well, I really liked where he took it. He basically was like, Christians should support the decriminalization of heroin because if they can outlaw drugs, they can outlaw your religion.
Well, it's very true. I mean, it's just a set of morals. It's your own personal decisions that you make and your values. And if in your values you think it's okay to take a little heroin, then that's your own business as long as you're not hurting somebody else.
Do libertarians believe in selling heroin to minors in vending machines?
Only if the machines are privately owned and operated.
Yeah. You know, Fox just wanted to discredit him by asking the heroin question right up front. And then they, like, played the answer over and over and over. And I looked on the internet and, like, there were so many articles the next day of, like, Ron Paul wants to legalize heroin.
In fact, a guy named Michael Gerson, I don't know if that's how you pronounce it, wrote an opinion piece recently in Washington Post about it. Just sort of, he compared it to social Darwinism. He said Ron Paul was mocking addicts as they descend into addiction. He said that when Ron Paul said this, he was making fun of it using the voice of a heroin addict. I think that's just how Ron Paul talks. He was talking his normal voice.
But Ron Paul doesn't talk like a heroin addict. Heroin addicts talk like this. Heroin addicts talk like this.
Right. But if you hadn't seen the debate and realized that this guy is full of crap who's writing this article, then you might think, oh, Ron Paul was making fun of heroin addicts. I don't think that's the case.
I didn't get that at all.
I didn't get that at all either. In fact, and people cheered when he said it. You know, it's the debate full of Republicans, although I'm imagining a lot of Paul heads, you know, went in there too. But every comment I saw from Ron Paul, it ended with uproarious applause, you know, even the heroin comment. And the thing about it, in this article that this guy writes, he tries to make the point that Ron Paul is anti-addicts, like he's wants to hurt these people who have this evil disease. And I'm thinking,
I didn't hear that at all.
No, not me either. This is the hit parade. This is Washington Post trying to put a hit on Ron Paul by saying things like this. And I'm thinking, so what's your alternative? It's more compassionate to throw people in cages because they're addicts? It's more compassionate to tase them and treat them like crap and make sure they don't have a life because once they're a felon for possession, they can't get a job? That's compassion? Whereas Ron Paul's thing is what's bad?
Yeah. It's crazy. Crazy. It's a bizarro world.
It is bizarro world. It's the bizarro world that the government knows what's best and adults can't make their own decisions. And we, as the benefactor, must provide for them and show them the way and the truth and the light. It's the religion of the state, really.
Reminds me of a comment we got on YouTube on the Guns and Weed movie recently. This guy, Bill J. 500, said, "I'm a gun owner and a medical marijuana patient. This, quote, movie, unquote, is teabagger propaganda." The random comment in it suggesting that teachers' unions are in some way related to the loss of civil liberties is ridiculous and ignorant. It's insane how the right-wing government persuades its followers to vote against things that are good for them, like healthcare and unions. Big business thanks you for believing and parroting these types of self-destructive ideals.
That's just completely ridiculous. The thing is, it's not like we think being healthy or having healthcare exist is a bad thing. We just right. think that anything the government touches, it turns to crap.
Yeah, and even if you want to take this guy as a dual issue guy, he likes guns and he likes weed. Teachers unions support the DARE program and they support stronger gun control.
They support zero tolerance.
Yeah.
They support treating everybody the same, the kindergarten mentality. Because one person screwed up, we have to treat you all like slaves and cattle.
It's like punishing the whole class.
Exactly. It's ridiculous, and it's an outdated mentality, and it's freedom stifling. It treats us all as one big mass instead of a bunch of individuals.
Yeah.
So, F that guy.
F that guy. And F the hit parade against Ron Paul.
Yes, definitely F the hit parade. But other than that, what do you think about this Herman Cain guy that Fox was trying to portray as the winner of the debates?
I think they just like him because he's black.
Right. He's the Republican Obama, it seems like.
Well, was he the CEO of Godfather's Pizza? I like what Cabrera right. said was, have you ever tasted Godfather's Pizza? If this guy can keep that company fiscally sound, he must be a financial genius.
That's great. John Stewart did a good bit on him, too. He said, so the Republicans' plan is a black guy with a funny name.
It's worked before.
The Daily Show played, you know, a little bit of his comments. He's a supporter of the fair tax. So I don't know if it seems like that's getting more popular. What do you think of this whole fair tax idea, Michael?
I don't think any taxes are fair.
Exactly. It's almost an oxymoron, isn't it?
You know, I mean, the basic idea is to eliminate all taxes except sales tax and just have like a 23% sales tax on everything.
Right, which they call a consumption tax.
Yeah. I don't think it would necessarily make – I mean, I think it would make – you wouldn't have to fill your taxes out every year. That'd be simpler. But really, I think it would – make more money for the government because they'd be able to tax anything black market. Or, you know, if you buy something black market and you go out and buy a big screen TV, you'd be paying lots of money on that.
Well, I think all it would do is it would create a black market for everything. Everybody would want to do things under the table. If there's something like a 23% or however high percent they'd have to do it to maintain the current government revenue levels, everybody's just going to do deals under the table.
In Europe, there are taxes almost that high on all so-called luxury items anyway. They call it a VAT tax. It's like a national sales tax.
The value-added tax?
Yes, it adds value. No, it doesn't.
It's anything that adds value to your life we're going to try to keep you from getting.
Yeah, but that's in addition to their really high other taxes.
And again, it's this idea of social control, I guess, in Europe of, you know, we want you to live the lifestyle we want you to live. If we deem it too excessive, again, it's our choice, not yours, but if we deem it too excessive, then it's subject to a certain amount of taxes.
Because the government has to pay for all the fancy laptops and guns they need, so they want to tax the hell out of your fancy laptops and guns.
Exactly. That's another good point. You never see the politicians limiting themselves as to what they can have. They're rolling around in their armor-plated cars and their airplanes and their helicopters and driving their limos.
And, you know, the government should have to pay sales tax on things. They don't. Think about that.
It's weird because there's so many different agencies, especially nowadays. I mean, there's just multiple layers of government and government-connected agencies, and some pay certain taxes, some don't. I always thought it was weird that people who are under the employ of the government pay income tax. Cops and firefighters. Yeah. I mean, they're sort of paying themselves then? How does that work?
The government works, gets things for way less than we do. You know, they buy, you know, a Glock. They buy millions of Glocks for all their agents. And they get them at a deal way lower than we get them. And they don't have to register them.
Right.
And to legally buy a machine gun, I mean, it's possible in some states. You have to pay you have to get a special tax stamp and go through a bunch of jump through hoops and fill out paper and register with the government. But for a citizen to buy a machine gun in America is generally between You know, like for machine pistols, it's like $5,000 more than the government would pay for them. And it's like $15,000 more for machine rifles than the government would pay for them. Like when they buy a full auto AR, you know, it's they pay the same that they pay for a semi-auto AR. And since some politician snuck something into some gun bill at some point in the 60s, the only machine guns that are available for citizens to buy are ones that existed in the country before that date. So,
but Michael, only cops and military should have machine guns.
Yeah. I don't personally have an interest in owning a machine gun. I like what Boston says is machine guns turn money into noise and semi-autos turn ammo into skill.
Yeah, that's a very good point. But the fact that they prevent you or put so many roadblocks in your way, whereas it's so easy for them, I guess, is the sticking point. I mean, hell, I want a anti-aircraft gun if I could have it.
So I got sick of my big-ass cop Glock 22. It was too big, so I went and traded it for a Glock 23.
Really? That quick, huh?
And that
Glock,
quick.
The Glock 23, is that just 40 caliber but shorter barrel?
Yeah, it's 13 plus 1. You know, 13 mag, one in the chamber. Although you can use bigger mags in it, but they just stick way out. Yeah, it's very concealable. It's like the size of yours. You're always cocking your gun in the background. I've noticed that.
Not always. Actually, that time I was opening a beer.
But one time you were like, here's what I think of the government, and click, click. It was random. It was random, but it sounded like you were making a comment.
Yeah, a lot of times I keep the gun just right next to me, you know. I guess you do that all the time, but sometimes the gun's in the other room, but for the most part it's on me, especially when I do the podcast, you know.
Yeah, but I've always got a bullet in the chamber, so there's no reason for me to be cocking it unless I'm decocking it and taking the bullets out of it.
I like the action of cocking the gun. You know, maybe it's just my upbringing, but in movies and video games, whenever somebody moves a gun, you hear the cocking noise.
Oh, I know. That's really annoying.
It is, but it's fun. It makes you feel like it's just to remind you that the guns are there. It's like, hey, look at these. There's guns.
And I've actually seen, like, you know, not just the disembodied cocking noise when they move it, but I've seen some. I was watching Law and Order recently, and there was like somebody holding someone hostage, and every time she yelled some command to the hostages, she'd cock the gun again, which would expel a bullet every time, but wasn't.
Ah, I see. You know, yeah, like, because if like, you pulled the slide back, it would eject the shell that's in the chamber already.
But it's like, I'm ready. I'm really ready. I'm really ready. I'm serious. You know,
I'm so sincere.
Yeah.
Yeah, for real. But what do we have next, Michael? Do we have a tyranny today?
Tyranny today.
Yeah. Here's a tyranny today. I got a bunch of them. I was reading this site, policeone.com. It's policeone.com. It's a site for cops, and it's pretty interesting. Anybody who's interested in what cops really think and how they think and what they say should check out this site. I saw a comment on there. It was an article on there, and it said that a common cop phrase is, be polite and professional, but have a plan to kill everyone you meet.
What do you think about that? I was kind of I had mixed feelings on that, because I could see almost the legitimacy of just being prepared and just every situation you're in sort of having a contingency plan.
I wouldn't phrase it that way.
I wouldn't either, especially when your motto is to protect and serve.
I know. Yeah.
So, but I mean, I guess that is kind of the mentality we worry about, right? It's the mentality of us versus them, and that's the mentality that they sort of have, is each one of us could be a potential, I guess, victim of the police state in their eyes.
Yeah.
Or a potential dissenter, which would make us, you know, a necessary victim of the police state. That's why they're so anti-resisting, you know, resistance. I mean, in a free society, if you feel like, you know, you're being unjustly taken into custody or trying to fight against illegal imprisonment, because such a thing exists, you know, if somebody doesn't have the moral right to kidnap you, then you have the moral right to resist, don't you think?
Yeah.
And yet, if you do, I mean, I wouldn't advise that, because these days, resistance
you'll end
can
up,
get
you'll
you
end
killed.
Up, you'll end up dead.
You'll end up dead. Yeah. And the police all have bigger guns than us, you know.
And there's more of them, and in a court, everything plays their way.
Yep. And I know here where I'm at, I'm not sure if this is how it works, but it seems as if just about every cop is issued, you know, their AR-15, and I'm sure they're select fire. You know, I'm sure they're not the truncated semi-automatics.
Yeah. They're at least burst fire. You know, they can fire three at once.
Right, right, right. And how are you going to win that? I was actually at a SWAT raid the other day, and I just realized how futile it is because...
As part of your work?
As part of my work. I don't want to get too into
it. Or you just listen to the police scanner, and when there's a SWAT raid, you show up and eat popcorn and watch it.
No, it was part of my work. And one of the things I'm sort of realizing is that, you know, when there's one of these SWAT activities, people look at it, you know, the average person looks at it these days and thinks, oh, there must be horrible things going on there if the SWAT team had to be called out. They don't think, oh, police use the SWAT team all the time now. They think, oh, these horrible people. The SWAT team came out there because there was a shooting earlier. Some of the people apparently ran in there, but that was their home. And the SWAT, you know, sort of blocked off the road for up to 6 hours. And there were kids in this home and this and that. And people are blaming the people inside, which, you know, they did do something morally wrong. But they're not the ones that's escalating the situation. They were there at home with their family. The cops with the machine guns around the kids, that doesn't seem to me to be their fault necessarily.
Well, that, you know, if there should be SWAT teams at all, that seems more like a reasonable thing one would be there for if you've got armed people and children inside. But they've been calling out SWAT teams for completely nonviolent things. I mean, you know, I don't know if it was a SWAT team, but raiding pacifistic Amish people at gunpoint for milk.
For milk.
And
yeah.
In Buffalo recently, there was a guy who downloaded some kiddie porn on his computer. And, you know, they knew about it. Like, they came the next day and raided him. It's not a violent offense. It's like, and he's not known to have guns. It's like, why can't they just knock on the door
right.
and arrest him for that? Why do they need right. a SWAT team for that?
Right, exactly. And, you know, it has gotten to that point in a lot of other places. It hasn't gotten that to that point here where I'm at yet. But yeah, like you said, there are lots of instances where there's no-knock raids. There was the no-knock raid where they shot the couple's dog and ended up finding nothing but a pipe with a little bit of weed residue in it.
Yeah.
Did you see
the thing recently about that link I sent you about the mass arrest, tear gas, sound weapons used against university students in Illinois?
That was horrible. That's the tyranny of the month, in my opinion.
That was mind-blowing. I mean, it was like, you know, it was this alcohol-fueled row party on the
it was Western Illinois University. It's their end of the year party. A bunch of college kids just
they have it every year.
Every year, it's their tradition. They do a little bit of drinking. They celebrate, you know, finals being over, or I guess it's dead week. So they celebrate the time in between classes ending and finals starting. Cops showed up and they had this dance they did. You know, they lined up. It was almost
Before that, it was weird. It was like the cops were there as they normally are. And, you know, arrested one or two people who are way out of control and breaking shit or whatever. But then all the cops left for a half hour.
Okay.
And, like, let it kind of escalate a little bit or whatever. And then came back, like, police state, like, you know, G20 style. Like, mass arrest, tear gas, sound weapons.
Right.
Trying to pull people out of their houses. In that video, there's one kid who tackles a cop. I mean, that was kind of brave of him. But that could have also been a false flag thing. Who knows?
The scary thing to me is, and if you see the video, I don't know if we can link it or what we can do.
I'll link it.
But if you see the video, there's sort of 40 cops in a line, you know, and they're sort of arm in arm, and they just sort of march down the street, pepper spraying people, pushing the crowd back. And the fact that they even have this planned out, you know, they have this plan to be in unison and push people back in crowd control is sort of what scares me, is that they have this set up to do that and to tyrannize people.
For nothing.
For nothing.
I mean, it looked like Nazi Germany with better weapons and armor. I mean, it looked like...
Or the civil rights movement riots, you know. It was almost like they were spraying people down with hoses. But these days, they have the sound weapons, which... Yeah, I'd never seen those in action before. It just looks like a big PA, but it had this really high-pitched, horrible sound, I guess, that's just... damaging people's ears.
It incapacitates you. John Stewart had a funny comment on that at the G20. He's like, you think this is going to bother these guys? They're anarchists. Have you heard the music they listen to? They probably have that sound as their ringtone. But no, it is horrible. And it's, I mean, it looked to me like just...
Another reason to keep your gun ears handy.
They'd probably arrest you for wearing your gun ears or something. But,
right.
You know, it looked like, well, we've got all this equipment. Let's go test it on somebody.
Yeah. They probably did a case study on it. They're going to write it up. Other municipalities are going to look at it for when they're deciding whether or not to order this special new weapon. I totally buy that.
Yeah. So So, Bahrain, we talked about last week about how they're arresting doctors for patching up the people that Bahrain's government shot.
Right.
They are now, Bahrain's rulers are now casting the net for loyalty oaths online.
Loyalty oaths online, right. They want people to be patriotic as they can be. And that's important to remember when you talk about patriotism, is patriotism is a lot of times just, there's a difference between loving your state and loving your country. And I think patriotism goes wrong when it's about loving the government and the bureaucracy and power.
Anybody who's patriotic, that means they feel they still have to be patriotic to whatever comes next. You know, the government can change almost overnight. Are you still going to be patriotic to that?
Right, exactly. And when your government becomes a tyranny, are you still going to be patriotic to that? To me, the real patriots are the people who love their country in the sense of they love the people. They love the place. They love whatever that is, but they don't love the government necessarily.
Yeah, a bumper sticker I've seen is, I love my country, but I don't trust my government.
Yeah, and I think that sort of encapsulates how people should feel.
Governments are insecure, you know. You have to restate that you love me on your Twitter account.
Right, right. But then when you think about it, I mean, here in America, you have to say the Pledge of Allegiance in the morning if you go to public school.
And that goes back to the governments are like abusive spouses, you know.
Right.
You got to tell me you love me, bitch, or I'll throw you in jail.
Every morning, yeah. And sing morning. Songs about how you die for me and how you love the people who did die for me.
Yeah. That's why I don't understand politicians who don't like what's going on with the government wanting to, like, put laws in that the Pledge of Allegiance is still said in school.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. People think that just because you sort of loving, you know, the constitutionalists or the framers or whatever America used to be, they feel like that's encapsulated by paying homage to the flag or paying homage to the state. But I think what we have to do is pay homage to ideas.
Well, the Pledge of Allegiance came much later and it was written by a socialist. I would think that people who deify the founding fathers probably wouldn't want to like the Pledge of Allegiance.
You would think that people get confused. They conflate all these sort of symbols, you know, because it's this shorthand in their mind. It's what they think of the flag and they think of freedom. But a lot of times the flag hasn't stood for freedom necessarily. I don't think we live in a very free country these days. I mean, when it comes to economic freedom, China's more capitalist than us. Jim Rogers did an interview recently where he said the Chinese right now are the best capitalist in the world. You know, that's where the venture investors are. That's where people are starting businesses. That's where people are going from rags to riches. Right now, you know, if you want to start a snow cone stand, the cops are going to bust you if you don't have the right permit, even if you're 12.
Yeah, and basically China wants to build up their military power, and they're doing it by making the market more free.
That might be a good point. I mean, I think it was Stefan Molyneux who said, you know, the freer a country is, if there's still a government, eventually that'll be the more tyrannical of the governments, because freedom obviously is an engine for revenue. And so if you have any sort of minarchist state and you have a lot of freedom, you're going to have a lot of tax revenue, you're going to end up being bigger. And that's sort of what happened to America. You know, America started out as sort of freedom, one of the freest nations in the world, and now we're a big tyrannical nation. So yeah. Maybe that's China's goal, is to let people be free for a little bit because they know freedom economically is what makes sense. Maybe they're seeking empire in the future and they're just going for the long play.
I'm wondering how long it's going to be before the United States government requires some sort of loyalty oath online on your Twitter or Facebook account or your cell phone or something.
Well, again, we see that with the – I mean, they don't need to require it these days. You know, on your Facebook, if you don't say, you know, I love you, America, or I support the troops, then in certain circles, you're going to be maybe blackballed. I mean, we have the people getting upset at people for not putting their hand over their hearts. Or, I mean, if you were at a certain sports game and you don't stand up for the national anthem, you know, we have all these sort of social pressures that maybe we don't need the government to require it. And that's part of – the public schools and the indoctrination is they're a little bit more savvy about it than Bahrain, obviously. They're not going to require you to go online. They're not going to push you to go online. They're going to instill it in you from the time you're a child and get it in your brain to where it's going to be a horizontal enforcement, to where everybody in society looks at you funny if you don't say the right patriotic things.
Well, or if you're not on social networks and don't have the right cell phone. I mean, I remember 15 years ago when I first got on the internet, way before there was social networking or anything, it's like if you wanted to be on the internet, you had to do web design and make your own site and then try to get people to look at it, which I did. But I made an observation that I remember posting on my website in 1996. I can't remember the exact wording, but it was something like, you know, I always thought that we'd end up with a police state where all the phones are bugged and all our mail is read. but I thought that it'd be forced on us. Whereas I think that with the internet, it's everyone's going to clamor to do it themselves.
Yeah. Yeah. I think so.
I mean, it's getting to the point where, like, you can't have a business if you don't have a Facebook account.
Yeah.
Because you won't do as well.
Right. Right. But, I mean, that's sort of a market thing to me. I mean, I think Facebook and social networking, at least that's more of a market pressure. And so that doesn't really upset me too much. But it's more the – I guess it's more the indoctrination you see in Americans when you see, like we saw when Osama bin Laden died, the kids out there doing the AK dance.
Well, there's a quote from one of the founders. I don't want to say it's Jefferson because people always misattribute things to him, but it's something like, if America's ever taken over by tyranny, it won't be a foreign government. It'll be from within under the guise of security.
I think that's a really good point. And that's sort of the point I bring up when people talk about freedom's not free. We need the military there to fight for your freedoms. If you like your free speech, you should think of it. When I think of the people who take away my freedom more than anybody else, all I can think of is federal, state, and local governments.
What was it you said about New York City, people being required to have something on their cell phone now?
Oh, right. In New York City, they want – it's called the Personalized Localized Alert Network. And so what they want to do is require all cell phone companies, and Verizon, AT&T are already on board. They're going to require a certain chip to be put in the phones so they can alert you if there's a terrorist attack. So they can say, oh, be scared now. You know, and have this sort of Pavlovian effect that they've had, you know, kind of like with the terror alerts being orange that you hear whenever you go to the airport. They want you to jump when they say jump. So you can opt out of it as a customer, but all eventually, it seems like it's going, all the phone carriers are going to have this certain chip put in to where the government can alert you if there's a terrorist attack.
That's Big Brother. You know, in 1984, everybody had this video screen in their house with propaganda streaming on it, and they could turn it down, but they couldn't turn it off.
Right, exactly. It's like your iPhone is going to be your telescreen now.
Yeah.
And maybe that's the next step. Maybe they're going to require the camera on your phone to always be recording you. I don't think it'll get to that, but obviously you set a precedent of requiring a government system in a private company's phone. That's the precedent you're setting.
Well, the U.S. Secret Service is now following you on Twitter. Everyone, following everyone. So that's the name of an article on Yahoo. It's basically the U.S. Secret Service now has a Twitter account and, you know, wants people to sign up and follow it. And people will. People will.
They have like 500 followers already.
Is that all? I didn't go to it. I won't even go to it.
That's what it says at the end of the article, which I guess was written on May 6th. So
well,
in its infancy, right. It already has 500 followers.
Should I go to it and see how many followers it has now?
Do you have a Twitter account?
Maybe.
I don't even have one.
Hmm.
So I'm not into the whole Twitter thing yet.
I just clicked on them, so my IP just went to them.
Okay.
Interesting. It's you click on it and there's nothing there.
It's because it's the Secret Service, Michael. Yeah, and how weird is that? The Secret Service wants to have something as public as a Twitter account.
That's not very secret.
No.
Well, I just clicked on it with my Twitter account, which is called Guns and Weeds, so that's probably not a good I shouldn't have done that, but f*** it. They, you know, this whole podcast is public. I'm sure someone is assigned to listen to all the freaky, we don't love everything the government does podcasts. You know, there's a room full of people somewhere in the country whose job it is to listen to this stuff.
I hope not, but I fear you may be right, and that's just more of the busy work that bureaucrats do.
I mean, I don't get any hits in the you know, I look at the web stats. I don't get any hits from government IP addresses, but they probably rent a house somewhere and just have people sit in the house and do it. So it's a non-government IP.
Right, right, right. Well, isn't the government supposedly building some kind of database somewhere where they want to hold like all the information on the internet? I don't know if they'd ever be able to go through it all unless they had some kind of special program, but
they have and they do. I mean, the thing you have to remember is that the internet was invented by the United States Army. It's kind of funny when everyone says, oh, the internet is ours. The government shouldn't be playing with it. They invented it. I still think they shouldn't be playing with it, but it was invented by ARPA, which is part of the U.S. military.
Right, right. But I mean, now, obviously, it's out of their control, I think. And I think when people talk about sort of an internet kill switch, you know, as Lieberman is fond of, I don't really think they could be able to do that and enforce it for an extended period of time without, you know, tremendous resources behind it.
No, but they do control the .com domain registration. That's, you know, when they grab those online poker sites, the next day, if you went to that site, it said this site has been seized by whatever government agency.
Right. But when the WikiLeaks thing happened, you know, they shut down that domain and there was a million different mirror sites. I don't really play online poker. Have there been mirror sites for the online poker? Would it even matter? Because I heard the accounts were frozen too of the people who had accounts with those.
Yeah, I don't know. It's all a shell game. You know, it's really like government and nanny laws are all trying to control human behavior, and human behavior will always find a way to thrive, even the good parts and the bad parts. I mean, look at the war on drugs. Is it stopping people from taking drugs?
No, people take drugs in prison,
which is the most controlled environment in the world. People also make and get weapons in prison. They could outlaw all the guns and people would still have weapons. I mean, first of all, anybody with some plumbing equipment can make a gun.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not that hard.
It's just a modern way of throwing a rock. And if you don't have guns, you're just going to have a bunch of rocks.
Yeah. And then, you know, what generally happens is people throw rocks or Molotov cocktails and then take the guns from the people that have the guns.
Right.
That's what happens in every modern revolution.
Yeah, exactly. You can't write things on paper and expect it to change the world, unless it's ideas. You can't do it with force. You can't write laws and expect people to comply with them when they inhibit the very life that people have, because people are always going to get around that.
Do you know about the Liberator Pistols in World War II?
No, but they sound awesome.
It was something that was made by the U.S. government to fight the Nazis, but basically they made it like when the war ended the next week, so they never actually used them. They made these little pistols that were stamped, not even milled, so they cost like $2 or $1 each to make. If you can find one now, they're worth thousands of dollars. Basically, it was a single-shot 45 pistol that was tiny. It was like the size of a Derringer, and it could fire 145. Basically, they were going to drop them for the Jews to use, and they came with directions in German and I think in Polish with pictographs and directions in the native tongue on how to use it. They said, like, go up to a Nazi soldier, ask him for a light for your cigarette, and then shoot him in the back of the head right under his helmet, and then take his gun and his uniform. And it came in a little box that had the pistol, the instructions, a little dowel for removing the fired shell, and 10 rounds of 45 ammo. And they were going to drop thousands of these for the Jews behind enemy lines. You know, it was basically a technique for taking a rifle from a Nazi.
Right, right. Yeah, I'm looking at them now on Wikipedia. Pretty cool looking little things. You should Google them if you're listening to this.
Yeah. My band Bomb had one of our record on Warner Brothers, the inside was guns and cookies, the inside artwork, and it was 1911s and Liberator pistols.
Nice, nice.
The Anger Brothers put that together. I didn't know what a Liberator was back then.
Okay, who are the Anger Brothers?
Really good friends. They kind of turned me on to guns. They're these two kind of really smart redneck artists from Oklahoma, and we met them there when we played in like 86 and told them that they should move to New York City, so they did, and they kind of got famous in the New York art world.
Are they the War Hippies guys?
Yeah, the War Hippies guys. Okay. They're fraternal twin brothers. They're in my movie DIY or Die, and they did the War Hippies song Cop on Every Corner.
Which is in Guns and Weed.
The Guns and Weed.
Right.
And Matt Anger also made that 1911 pin that was on DJ's purse in the scene where our friend is putting the gun in the purse in the kitchen.
Right, right.
And Mark Anger recently died of cancer. I'm really bummed out about that.
Oh, I didn't know about that.
Yep.
My condolences.
Yeah, he was like my age.
Bummer.
Yes.
Speaking of cancer, did you see that story? I think it was out of Montana, a father whose baby infant son had brain cancer, was on chemo.
And he gave him pot.
He gave him, I think it was cannabis oil. Eventually, the cancer cleared up and the baby's doing fine right now.
I mean, it'd be hard to say whether that was a cause and effect
right,
thing, but...
Right.
And the FDA is like arresting doctors or sending them cease and desist letters of like, you can't legally say that pot cures cancer.
Right, right. Which is a really scary thing because obviously there's something there. No matter what you believe, I think you have to at least admit that there's some type of benefit to it. It's not just a bunch of chemicals that people put together like meth. It's a plant, it's natural, and somehow it has some type of good benefits. Whether or not those outweigh the bad in everybody's mind, I think it's irrelevant. I think the relevant point is how tight of an iron fist the government has on keeping people from even exploring it, of keeping there from being a real, true free exchange of ideas between doctors and actual professionals on the matter.
Yeah, bastards.
It really is upsetting. And What's also upsetting is the states that aren't taking as strong a stand, I think, as they should. But I guess that's all, you know, a lot of people talk about nullifications and states' rights. But in the end, I think, you know, state governments, they're still governments. And so here in Washington, we recently had a bill that was supposed to, you know, redefine a lot of the medical marijuana situation here, because it's still not known whether or not dispensaries are supposed to be legal across the state. You know, some get shut down, some don't get business licenses, different counties have it different ways. And so there was this bill that was supposedly, a lot of people had problems with it, but it was supposedly supposed to take care of that. The governor vetoed most of it because she said she didn't want her state employees to be arrested by the feds for giving business licenses to dispensaries because it's still federally illegal.
Yeah.
So
politicians, they always run on less taxes. You know, the governor of Wyoming did, and now Wyoming is starting for the first time to, if you order something on the internet and it's shipped by truck, they're sending you a letter. Like, you know, they check the manifest at the state line when the trucks have to check in. I have a friend that bought several thousand dollars worth of furniture recently online and had it shipped in to her. And weeks later, she got a letter from the state of Wyoming saying you owe us usage tax on
Ugh,
that.
Are you serious?
Yeah, I thought Wyoming would be the last place that was doing that. I've been hearing about that for about a year on some, you know, some states were doing it.
Well, if you remember, there was the gun show showdown when the state auditor had a problem with people not – they wanted people to pay their taxes at the gun shows, and that people didn't want to pay the taxes, and they made a big stink about it. Of course, that was when a Democrat was governor. Matt Mead sort of ran, and Matt Mead, you know, he sort of got less and less liberty-loving, or seeming liberty-loving.
Well, he sounded like a radical who hated the federal government until he won, and that's how he won the primary. Right. And then once he won the primary, he sounded really statist.
Well, on that story we did with him where we went out shooting, he showed us this 223 rifle. It wasn't a AR-15. It was made by like Sig Sauer or something. He was like, yeah, I bought like six of these after Obama got elected. You know, trying to play that card, even though he's, you know, was a federal attorney and this and that. And then when he won the primary, you know, I was there at the press conference and I asked him about his stance, his different stances that he had taken. You know, I think it was about the Firearms Freedom Act, or maybe it was about No Child Left Behind. There was a bunch of different issues that Wyoming had with, you know, bending under the federal yoke. And he sort of just blew them off at that point once he won the primary.
Yep.
So it just goes to show you, politicians are more concerned with getting elected, getting their donations, playing the game, than they are with any of the ideas they actually talk about.
People are so statist, so many of them. You know, I was thinking about like that thing of how a lot of times when people get arrested, you know, like you said, well, if the SWAT team's there, they must be guilty. You know, a lot of people, when they say, well, I'm glad that guy's in jail, I mean, that's really kind of sociopathic and kind of cruel. You know, unless the person that's in jail is committing violent crimes, if they're committing nonviolent crimes and your neighbor or your friend or somebody you know says, that's good he's in jail, you should not have that person as a friend, I think, because that person is A, sociopathic, and B, really fucking cruel. Right. You know, that's mean.
Yeah.
It's mad. It's sadistic.
It really is sadistic. And there's a ton of problems with jail. I mean, one of the big problems I think I have with jail is, say somebody steals something from me. You throw him in jail. My tax dollars are going to feed him.
I don't get my money back.
My tax dollars are going to feed him and give him a bed. Yeah, there may be restitution. The judge may rule for the restitution, but that's an afterthought. I'm never going to see that money. If I do, it'll be 5 years later once he gets out of jail. They're not going to garnish his wages to pay that. They may garnish his wages to pay for child support or something, but that's only because the government thinks that the child belongs to the government.
I like the lib pair idea in L. Neil Smith cartoons. It's basically, if somebody's caught stealing, their punishment is they have to wear a shirt that says, I was caught stealing, and they have to go work for the person they stole from until they pay back and then some.
Right. I mean, that should be the way it works. You make it right. You make me whole. Isn't that what's important? But I think a very telling thing about the U.S. legal system is when it's something like larceny or theft or murder, it's always crimes against society. It's always the state versus them.
Well, the state does everything that they charge people for. One of the most hypocritical for me, I think, is RICO laws. You know,
racketeering, yada yada yada.
Racketeering, you know, like having a criminal
enterprise. The ones they use to bust organized crime in the mafia.
Yeah, but they use it on everybody. They use it on, you know, two friends who deal drugs together now. But the thing is, I mean, the biggest RICO, the biggest racketeering is the government.
Right, right. As Murray Rothbard said, they're just a gang of thieves writ large. And they really are. And supposedly we have this gang problem here in some of the eastern Washington cities, but gangs are just small states. They're just small governments. They're a group that is a collective to where the individuals give up their lives to the collective and they use violence to get what they want.
Word. So talk about monopoly of violence. We should actually play that little clip of Obama saying he wanted a monopoly of violence.
Okay, go ahead and play that, Michael.
All right.
If you start building a military premised on the use of private contractors and you start making decisions about armed engagement based on the availability of private contractors to fill holes and gaps, that over time you are, I believe, eroding the core of our military's relationship to the nation and how accountability is structured. I think you are privatizing something that is what essentially sets a nation state apart, which is the monopoly on violence.
Okay, that was the Obama clip about monopoly of violence. Explain monopoly of violence.
Well, that's one of the definitions of government. You know, you hear a few definitions of government. One is, or a definition of politics, for instance, is who gets what when. One of the definitions of government is a monopoly of violence within a given territory. And that's really what it is. That's what it boils down to, is whoever controls the government in a specific jurisdiction decides who gets thrown in jail for what, who gets executed for what, and what rules people have to abide by lest they get thrown in jail in a cage or murdered or taxed or have to pay a fine. Of course, violence is what it all rests on, because otherwise, as in our movies, it's just a suggestion, unless it's backed up by force of violence.
A government can write laws until they run out of paper or run out of ink. But unless they're willing to pick up a gun and put someone in a cage for breaking those laws are really just suggestions.
And the monopoly part comes in the fact that the society is bred to buy into the fact that it's legitimate when a government does it. It's okay if the SWAT team accidentally shoots somebody because it's collateral damage. It's okay if we accidentally kill 80 civilians to one terrorist in Pakistan because it's a government job. They have the monopoly on these kinds of things. That's their job. They're just doing what we pay them to do.
Well, I like the libpair idea. You know, people wonder, like, how would that happen without guns? Like, okay, if you steal from somebody, you're caught, you have a trial, private trial, and you're sentenced to go work for the person and wear the shirt that says, I'm a thief. What if you said no? And the answer in the L. Neil Smith libpair is you would be shunned by society and you wouldn't be able to eat or drink or find a place to stay or anything. And then you'd end up living and working on the mines on the asteroids, which is incredibly incredibly dangerous. But, you know, there it is again. You go to a moon. It's not the moon, but it's a moon, which always plays in libertarian paradise.
Right. And I think that's a good point. And that goes back to, as we see now, we have this big – the state doesn't do most of the legwork for enforcing itself. It is the people. It's the society who, for some reason, believe in the state, and they enforce it horizontally. So if you had no state, you would still have society's norms being enforced on that horizontal level. So like you say, if somebody doesn't – it's almost like a credit score. If somebody doesn't buy into whatever the private judge says or whatever the private jury says, then they get a reputation. And in these days where you have the internet and social media, it'd be very easy to point out who you shouldn't do business with, who you should trust and who you shouldn't trust. I think with places like eBay, you see, and places like Amazon, you see this work so beautifully. You have the ratings. You have negative feedback. You have positive feedback. I'm more likely to buy something from somebody on eBay or do business with them if they have, you know, the 5-star rating or 100 different positive feedbacks for a lot of different transactions. So whereas if they have a bunch of negative feedback, which I don't think can even happen, because I think if they get a certain amount of negative feedback, people will just stop doing business with them.
Yeah.
So it becomes in your own interest to work. Otherwise, I mean, where's the benefit for you? It doesn't benefit you anymore to be a criminal in that sense.
Yeah, I mean, that's self-regulating without the threat of violence.
Right, exactly.
And, you know, the real statist people always want to increase the government's monopoly on violence. See, the United States is an interesting country because it's one of the only countries where gun ownership is relatively legal. Like one thing that like Barbara Boxer is promoting a bill right now. It probably won't go anywhere, but it's probably just one of those testing the waters bills that would make shall issue concealed carry permit may issue nationwide.
Yes, and ugh, I hate the title. The Common Sense Concealed Firearms Permit Act. They put the word common sense in there as if everybody believes it's right to keep people from owning guns.
She's holophobic. Do you know that word?
No, but I want to hear it.
It's a psychiatric term for a fear of weapons. It's a phobia, and it's an actual diagnosis. And, you know, it's usually used on people that have an unnatural fear of weapons. Like, you know, if they see a bow and arrow in someone's garage, they start screaming. Or if they see a peace officer cop with a gun, they freak out and run away. Or if they see a citizen with a gun, they run away. It's holophobia.
Right. The thing about this Barbara Boxer thing, included in the language, it says the different governments on the federal level will make states have to have some type of good cause clause for people to be able to have a gun. They would have to prove that they have good cause to have a gun.
Yeah.
So basically the bureaucrats get to decide whether you get to defend yourself or not. To me, it seems like I should decide what my good cause is. Am I right?
And I heard someone say that if this was enforced in Wyoming, cops wouldn't enforce it because everyone's got to live somewhere.
The thing about Wyoming, though, a lot of the Wyoming cops are actually transplants from somewhere else. You know, it's hard to get enough, especially the way police departments run right now with needing so many different people. A lot of times they get their new hires from other states, people who sort of are looking for cop jobs and go online and they see this opening and they decide, hey, I'm going to move to Wyoming to get my cop start.
Sometimes people that weren't good enough to be cops somewhere else, or sometimes cops that were too violent to be cops somewhere else, they got fired.
Yeah, even that.
Although, even so, the cops here are really mellow compared to anywhere I've ever lived.
Oh, definitely. And the nanny laws seem to be less. I'm not saying they're – I mean, obviously, they have the new spice ban, and there's a lot of horrible things out there right now. But, for instance, traffic tickets. When I lived in Wyoming, so cheap. I mean, yes, I still don't believe in them. I'm still getting screwed, and it's the principle of the thing. But $60 for speeding, whereas in Texas, it's $250, and then they tack on another $250 if you're late for your court date. It's a bit
different. And that is something that I study. I mean, that kind of logistics is part of why I moved to Wyoming. And there are some people that are libertarian that I think are kind of theorists in a way, because they're so into pointing out that all government is immoral. They don't notice that there's less government somewhere. You know, there's people in California that complain about the state, but they live in California. You know, I think if you're really into freedom, you're going to move somewhere that you can be left alone more.
Yeah.
Especially with guns.
It really does make a difference. As a young anarchist, I was so much more happier living in Wyoming than I am now living in Washington. And for people who don't know, Washington, you know, I heard Jim Rogers on an interview say California is more communist than China. California is sort of where Washington gets its sort of feel as far as politics go. To me, we're a West Coast state. Feels almost like I'm in California here.
Well, Oregon and Seattle are full of people that couldn't make it in San Francisco.
Okay.
Really, literally.
I could totally buy that. But just the way I feel dirty almost living here in Washington. There's so much more government. I see it so much more when I'm outside. I see the signs in the park. I get the letters. I read the stories. It feels a lot different than when
I can't believe you want to move back to Texas or even consider it.
Well, that's mostly for family. And there are places in Texas where you can be sort of left alone out in the country. Texas is such a big state that there are sort of some places where if you can duck the cops enough, then it's almost like living in Wyoming, but you have to try a lot harder to duck the cops.
Well, Obama was in Texas today on the border giving a speech about immigration reform, which to me basically means give a bunch of people the right to vote Democrat.
Yeah.
And talking about increasing federal intervention in Texas to solve this problem the government made.
Of course. Well, in fact, you know, Ron Paul recently had another hit piece on him from an immigration website, you know, that's, you know, for strong borders and, you know, all that good stuff. And they gave Ron Paul an F. But it was mostly because of his comments where he's saying, you know, the problem is that we have these social programs in the first place for the immigrants to take advantage of. It's not necessarily that we have immigrants. If you have these systems of free money, of welfare, of all these benefits, people are going to try to people are going to take advantage of them. People are going to find a way to take advantage of them, whether it's immigrants or other subsets of society.
I'll tell you what I would
strike at the root of the problem. Don't strike at the symptoms.
Here's what I would consider perfect immigration reform. Eliminate welfare, eliminate corporate welfare, eliminate public schools, let anyone who wants to carry a gun, who's not violent, carry a gun, legalize drugs.
Legalize drugs, exactly.
And then just open up the borders.
Yeah, exactly, exactly. Basically eliminate the state. Then you won't have to worry about immigration.
Yep.
You won't have to worry about people crossing from one monopoly of violence to another monopoly of violence.
Yeah.
All borders are where the monopoly of violence starts and stops.
Different flavors of monopoly of violence.
Different flavors of statism, exactly. So
yeah. So yeah. 1 in 7 Americans get food stamps now.
Is it really that high?
Yep. And Wyoming has the lowest rate, which is pretty surprising because we have an Indian reservation.
Yeah. Yeah, that is surprising. Well, although the Indian tribes that live there, I mean, there's only, what, 5,000 Shoshone and 8,000 Arapaho, so...
Yeah. Which some people would think is a racist comment on my part, but Native Americans get food stamps at a higher rate than the rest of the people in the country.
Right, right. And, you know, the reservation in general is a bit more dependent on federal and state subsidies than, you know, another jurisdiction.
Speaking of race and Indians, my buddy in India, dot Indian, not feather Indian, thought you were Indian... dot Indian derivation in the movie.
When I played Johnny Patel?
Well, he loved that, but he also just, he thought you were.
Oh, okay. Well, yeah. I mean, technically, Iranians are supposed to be Aryans, and Indians are supposed to be Aryans, too. So, and in fact, Farsi, you know, the language people speak in Iran, is Indo-European, which means, you know, India and Europe, because supposedly we're all descendant from the Aryans who were, you know, sort of in Europe and traveled through Iran and into India. So, There's some connection there between Persians and Indians.
Why did Hitler call himself Aryan?
Well, I mean, I guess he supposedly did have the right. Like I said, that Aryan is sort of a race that encompassed, you know, that part of Europe and Iran and India. And that's why, you know, Farsi, for example, has its roots in the same language roots as, you know, a language like German or English or Hindi, instead of a language like Arabic or Hebrew, which are Semitic languages. So they do share us. In fact, during World War II, Iran was technically neutral, but we were sort of leaning on the Hitler side, actually.
We, meaning
not
your ancestors?
Not we, but yeah, them. I hate the we. In fact, I was talking to my wife last night, and she was like, oh, you're using the royal we. And I was like, no, that's the socialist we. Because I think there's a socialist we, too. And that's the we when we're not talking about, you know, kings and queens.
The socialist we. I'm going to put that in the show notes.
Yeah, that's the we, as in we need to do such and such. We need to stop foreign aid to such and such.
Or we need to give foreign aid to such and such.
Yeah, sorry. We need to give foreign aid to such and such. Or what would we do about the roads? You know, when people say, what would we do? What would we do about criminals if we had an anarchist society? It's the, what's this we? Do you have a turd in your pocket?
A mouse. I like saying mouse.
In libertarian paradise, there is no we. There's me and whoever I choose to associate with, and that's a we. But if you're asking me this question, then I probably don't choose to associate with you.
Yeah. You're the most post-racial person I've ever met, and I say that because the time that we were at the Tea Party thing and you said something about, God, I'm really sick of this, everything George Bush is doing. And I'm like, what? He's not president anymore. And you said, oh, Obama. I get him mixed up.
They are easy to get mixed up. I mean,
to most people.
I really feel like Obama is the third Bush term.
Yeah.
And it's hard to argue that it's not. I mean, most things that I disliked about Bush, Obama just does worse. And have you seen that picture? There's a picture, actually. It's a morph of George Bush
in our
Obama's
movie.
Face.
It's in our movie.
It is in our movie. It's also in my video, I Own Me.
Yeah.
But, I mean, it's the war on terror, the economy, the government intervention is the economy, the Federal Reserve. Everything I hated under Bush, I still hate under Obama. It just seems like it's gotten worse. And, I mean, Obama's white, too. He's not just black. He's white, right? His mom was white.
Yeah.
So...
it's funny how one race will claim somebody and another race will disavow somebody when they're, right. You know, it's like...
Do you remember the race draft in the Dave Chappelle show?
Yes, I loved it. Who's the golfer? The black golfer?
Tiger Woods. The Asians get Tiger Woods.
Yeah.
The blacks get Eminem. We pick Eminem. Yeah. Whatever happened to Dave Chappelle? I could really use some more Chappelle show in my life.
Yeah, me too.
He was a funny cat. You know, I think part of what it was, and I actually wrote this down this morning, I wanted to talk about it at the top of our forecast, is...
Forecast.
We're the forecast. We forecast how the government's going to tyrannize you tomorrow. Sort of the way...
Well, I mean, that's all a weather forecast is basing on existing data of what's happened before and what's happening today. You have a probability for what'll happen tomorrow. This, it works the same with tyranny.
Right, right. And it's never perfect, just like ours.
Yep.
But what I was thinking of this morning is I was reading this article actually in Double XL, which I don't read often, but I picked it up because Lupe Fiasco was on the cover. Shouts out to Lupe if you know who I'm talking about. But it was about how he was trying to make his album and the record company just wanted hits. You know, Lupe is really critically acclaimed. He has a big fan base, a big cult following for his sort of political raps and his sort of stances on things. And that's sort of what he's known for. But he effed up and actually made a hit on his second album. And the record company just wants that. That's all they care about. They're looking at that and they want to see that again. He didn't want to make songs like that necessarily. And it almost screwed up his whole life. I think that you see that a lot. You have these sort of established interests, and they're always, you know, tied to the government in some way because, again, the government is sort of this establishment. It's the status quo of the way things work. And when you're a businessman sometimes, especially of a large corporation, you have to see that status quo continue because that's how you sort of plan the way you're going to make your money. So I think a lot of times there is a problem. If you want to be an artist, if you really want to tell the truth, I think – the best way to go is to try to do it independently. That way you don't have executives telling you how you should do your art.
I can say that as someone who was signed to Warner Brothers at one point.
Really? I figured you would, and that's one of the reasons I was thinking of it. In fact, I interviewed Tech Nine back when I worked in Wyoming. They wouldn't let me do that here in Washington, but I got to interview Tech Nine and go sit on his tour bus. He's another rapper, if you know who I'm talking about. Shouts out to Tech Nine. And he paints his face and all this and does all this crazy stuff. And, you know, his record label didn't want him to do that stuff either. You know, they just wanted the hit. Just we'll pick a beat for you. We'll have a hook, somebody sing a hook on it, and you just do some verses about, you know, booze and girls. He didn't want to do that. And he said, you know, I just got to do me. And that's why I started my own label. And so it's harder to do. But I think if you want to put yourself out there and you want to stay true to yourself, the best way to do it is to try to do it independently. And that doesn't mean alone. You can find other like-minded people, but stay away from the establishment in all its forms.
Yeah. Well, I think Lupe Fiasco has compromised in some way. I saw him on Colbert last night, and he was doing some really poppy tune with some chick singing backup. Who is she? Do you know?
Well, it depends on what song it was. I didn't see the Colbert.
Some white chick with looks like kind of gothy.
Oh, I'll have to check it out. We'll come back to it. I'll do a case study of it, and we'll talk about
it. A case study. Speaking of case studies, what do you think of psychiatry?
Well, from what I understand, psychiatry is sort of another arm of the state. I mean,
Become that.
To be a psychiatrist, you have to have certain licensing and certain approval. And again, to have certain higher level degrees that allow you to be a psychiatrist, you have to be approved by, you know, you have to write your dissertation. It has to be approved by people who are on the board. Of course, they're all people who are academics who owe their tenure to praising the state. And so I think psychiatry is just sort of another way of making people feel bad and drugging people when they don't do things that society or the state considers normal.
A lot of them tend to be really anti-gun ownership, too. Like, if you go to a shrink and you happen to mention in passing that you own and enjoy guns, they're going to put that down as a hmm.
As a hmm. Or drugs. Yeah. Or drugs. Yeah. Or any kind of drugs that they don't prescribe, of course. It's the war on some drugs, not the war on all drugs.
Well, you know, I found out recently that there are only 33 practicing psychiatrists in the state of Wyoming. I kind of like that.
Yeah.
I've lived in neighborhoods that had 33 practicing psychiatrists.
I can see that, definitely in California. In California, honestly, you almost need it.
Yeah.
Not that you would need it, but California, I can imagine, makes people crazier than other places to live in.
Yeah, and it's really hip to be in therapy there, too. It means you're interesting.
You know, I've gone to shrinks before. I do find them helpful in the sense that sometimes it's good to just get it out there and talk to an anonymous person. Not necessarily anonymous, but a person who's disinterested. But I think the problem is sometimes psychiatrists aren't disinterested. Sometimes they're interested in pushing you into conformity.
And the way they do it, asking questions until you give the answer or the opinion that they want. I don't like that.
Almost,
I
went to some like an interrogation.
Or more like the Delphi method. I went to some as a kid. Basically, my psychiatric problem was disrespect for authority. So they sent me to the school shrink and then to another shrink for a little while.
So then they sent you to see an authority?
Yeah. And, you know, I didn't go along and they didn't lock me away, but it was, they come from a place of like, I'm right, you're wrong, I know everything, I'm going to let you talk and guide you until you come to my realization.
Right, right. They are very much the experts, they believe, in that situation, which is kind of tough because they're not you. It seems like you would be more of an expert on you.
Most of the therapy of any kind that I've had that has worked has been talking to friends or talking to like-minded people, you know, kind of peer-to-peer therapy. Like in AA, I mean, I truly believe that an alcoholic can stop being an active alcoholic better by hanging out with former active alcoholics than they can by talking to someone who's got a PhD in drugology who's never been an alcoholic,
right,
or
right.
an addict, you know?
Right. Somebody who's read the right amount of textbooks.
Yeah.
Somebody who's credentialed.
They don't have the answer because they've never had the same feeling. They just have studied it, and it's not the same as having been there. And, you know, like when I first got married and I wanted advice on marriage, I didn't go to a marriage counselor. I went to a friend who'd been married for 20 years.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I actually got added on Facebook recently by this chick I used to know who has been married for 2 years and is a marriage counselor. She's just decided she's a marriage counselor and put up a website. And as I recall, this was somebody who had really broken relationships with men. And I remember her like screaming at her boyfriend in my house. And I'm like, really? She's a marriage counselor now.
Maybe she's a quick learner. Again, I think that's part of the problem with our credentialing system these days is if you put in the time and get the right piece of paper, people defer to you sometimes without even really looking at what your work or what it is that you've done.
Well, that's why I wrote a book called $30 Film School, because I didn't believe that schools teach what people need to know. There are comments from people who say that that book is just a complete scam, but there are people who want to go to film school and spend $30,000 a year. And then there are people who've read the book and made the movie and said, you know, spend the $30,000 making your movie, don't spend it on film school. This book's better.
Yeah, exactly.
The book came with a DVD, a CD in the first edition and a DVD in the second edition. And one of the things on it was a printable diploma. So you read the book and then you print the diploma and you sign it yourself.
Again, just another piece of paper, right?
Yep.
It's no, barely different from any other piece of paper. It's still made of dead trees. Word.
Well, I think we can wrap up. I think people should go rate and review the podcast on iTunes. It helps it get seen by more people. And we have t-shirts for sale now that people can go on the website.
Most definitely.
And life is good. We're still free. We're still sucking air. We're still above ground. We're still pretty free, walking around with our guns and our freedom and our love of life.
I think the most important thing is if you're free in your mind, and I'm free in my mind. Are you free in your mind, Michael?
Most of the time.
Okay, them hoes can lock your body, but they can't lock your mind. Just remember that, and I think that's our note of positivity, is freedom Word. Comes from inside of you.
Worms.
All right.
All right.
Peace. Let's
save this. Peace.
Hello, freedom fiends. It's your boy, Dean, from the U.S. Get the U.S. out my bloodstream. I owe me in the include endorphins. No one won't ask permission, and I won't say please. Freedom fans, for fact that I gotta make clear.
The Freedom Fiends podcast is covered by a Creative Commons Attribution Sharealike 3.0 license. Do what you want with it and spread it around. Tell two friends. Make copies. Email it to everyone you know. Go on the site and comment. This is a conversation. Every Friday night, we'll have an exciting new episode where Michael W. Dean and Neema Vedadi weave their own unique take on the way the world works and how to find your place in it. Available from freedomfiends.com. That's freedomfiends.com. Subscribe and tell two friends.
And remember, the only power they have is the power you allow them.